For an adult audience, LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised.
LoveLine with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
Hey, everybody, it's LoveLine. I'm Adam, that's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Dr. Drew, board certified physician, addiction medicine specialist. Oh.
Smoked almonds, Adam.
Yeah, got a nice big can of smoked almonds. I'm not going to eat these.
No,
I'm going to put them in a Cuisinart, liquefy them, and inject them into my main vein.
I see. I thought you were going to do the smoked almond enema.
No. Ooh.
Mm.
Nice. Drew, I'm going to need you to help me by squeezing the pastry sack for the enema. Now, you might get a little backwash, but then once we get the flow going the right direction, we'll be fine. It's like when you siphon
gas.
Tube.
Yes, of course.
First mouthful is going to be gasoline, but then we're rolling. No guests tonight. Thank Christ. I've had an ass full of people.
What happened to David Allen Greer?
What happened
He's
to him?
He's a little too big for us now.
Mm. Yeah, that's my question.
I've become a fan of his show. That's probably the kiss of death.
Let me say this about David Allen Greer. I have two things, which is David Allen Greer was supposed to come in tonight, so what happened? And then my next question is, what happened? You see what I'm saying,
yeah,
Drew?
Yeah, I see it.
What happened to Dag? Dag is, now I look up here, he's coming in on the 11th.
All right.
So we'll find out what happened. And next week, my dear friend Dickie Barrett is going to be in here, lead singer of the Mighty Mighty Boss Tones, and of course, new announcer for Jimmy Kimmel Live.
Mm-hmm.
So he'll be in here. Let's get to see him on a daily basis now. Nicole Richie from The Simple Life, you know, that new Fox show. And Josh Molina from The West Wing and
David Allen Greer.
Yeah, and Dag. All right. So where are we, Drew? Oh, yeah. A couple things I want to say. First off, I had to get up very early this morning to meet a cement pumper and work something out that was starting very early. So I got up real early. And then I didn't get a good night's sleep last night, but the point is I was thinking about how tired I was when my wife informed me that my number came up for jury duty.
Oh.
And I was supposed to be downtown tomorrow at 7:45, and I'm tomorrow. Tomorrow. And
I'm
tomorrow. I'm pre-miserable. And here's my point. Here's my point. I'm thinking of not going. And let me tell you something about being a literal millionaire. My wife was reading the thing and said, could get up to a $1,500 fine.
Take it.
And I said, take it. I make more than that.
No, take it.
That's what I said.
Yeah. Do not. It is worth $15,000 not to go down there.
Damn it. Ooh.
I'm serious. It is miserable. It's wretched.
But here's what I worry. Is there going to be a manhunt? Somebody tell me how this works. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I don't mind paying a fine. I'm fine with that. And by the way, who's left for juries these days? I mean, you got to think about this. You know when they do these trials like, hey, Scott Peterson is on trial. We got to go find some guys that never heard of Lacey or Scott Peterson or the whole case that went on in Modesto.
And have about 3 months to set aside.
Yeah. And who look at the $9.26 a day they get paid is a nice bump. They're moving up a bracket. Yeah. I mean, think about, and by the way, I mean, I don't know what, we got to just invent some sort of goddamn supercomputer to figure all this out. Because here's what goes on with juries. Smart people, busy people, effective people don't have time to do this.
Mm-hmm.
And so what you end up with is people who really shouldn't be deciding the fate of other people.
No, you do. The problem is now they take everybody and they cram their butts into these rooms. Everybody.
Yeah.
That's the amazing thing. And there are people there who really shouldn't be there. They have family commitment. There are things they shouldn't
But how about the people they try to get together, like when I go, like, we got to find people that aren't familiar with the OJ case.
Yeah.
Like, really?
Yeah.
And if you did truly find somebody who...
Who is that?
A year and a half after the Nicole Brown murder, I had never heard of OJ or Nicole Brown. Aren't you talking about someone who's effectively retarded, at least socially?
Has to be.
But you got to set the Wayback Machine for the 1700s and go to the Ozarks, right?
Yep.
That's the person you want?
Mm.
Okay.
It's a great system.
But listen to my plan. And why can't we work this out? All okay.
Here it is. Okay.
I'm serious about this. What about a super lie detector? That is it.
Because they don't care. They don't care about his guilt or innocence.
I want all the great minds of society, besides myself, because I'm going to be busy doing other things. I want all the great scientific minds to get together and to agree on a world device. A device that's good in every country, in every part of this country, and parts beyond, that is a lie detector. It's part supercomputer, part plethysmograph. You know what that is, Drew? They put a ring around your penis.
Yes, I know.
Yeah. It's part everything. And it's tested extensively at the greatest universities in the world. And then 5 years from now, that's it. This is the device. We scan retinas. We check sweat. We check tumescence. We check, put a probe in your ass, and that's it. And it's 10 minutes. It's 10 minutes and it's done.
Greg's an attorney. When I see if a legal mind would have any problem with this?
Drew's agent's an attorney. No.
No. Okay.
It isn't. Look, we agree. Here's the deal. Here's the deal with the breathalyzer. It's a piece of technology that came around some years ago. We check. We decide. Here's how we can tell how much alcohol blood levels in your system. A breathalyzer and a blood test. This is how. Hey, if you say I don't want to take it, that's just as good as being a drunk driver. That's it. Yeah. That's it. We agree on it.
All right.
Okay. That's it. That's it. There's no more juries. There's no more judges. No more anything. OJ, we pull OJ in the very first day he comes in. It's like, hey, OJ, we think you killed your wife. Hey, Robert Blake, we think you may have. Hey, everybody. Hey, Scott Peterson. Hey, John Malvo. Hey, everybody that's just taking up all the space, all the resource, all everybody. I don't care if you stole a Pez dispenser. You just come in. It's like, pow, you're hooked up. Oh, you passed. You're gone. Oh, you don't want to take it? Well, that's guilty. It's just the same as the guy won't take the breathalyzer. That's it.
I like your word.
We agree on it. We extensively test it like any other device. But and then that's it. We're done.
Slippery slope, Adam. Slippery slope.
Yeah, I know.
Prison will be testing for everything.
Listen, all you, I don't know. What is it? It's like the ACLU meets a bunch of Trekkie homos all get together and worry about some sort of horrible conspiracy where the president is brought in and somebody takes a leak on the machine and he's found guilty of murder and we string him up an hour later. What are you guys worried about? Let's get things moving. One out of every 500. And listen, and this argument, too, thing where they go like, if one out of every 500 million guys is found guilty when he was innocent, then that's too much. No, it's not. That's perfectly acceptable. Totally fine with that. Once in a while, society needs a martyr, and it might be that homeless guy didn't actually put the shiv in the Salvation Army lady's side. Do you know what I mean?
Hmm.
We get this device, we're done. That's it. We move.
Utopia.
There's no more speculation. Michael Jackson? Michael Jackson's over 3 months ago. It's all done. And I'm sleeping in tomorrow morning. How archaic can we get? We just get a bunch of retards, drag their ass down to the courthouse and sit there and give each other the stink eye for 6 months. Nothing going on. And then when it's all said and done, the guy who kills his wife, the guy who kills his friend, and the guy who allegedly, chops up his neighbor in his apartment, dumps him in the river, he's walking because the retards have voted. Well, that's a hand count. Hand count of tards. What do we got? Well, he's walking. That's it? That's what we end up with. We end up with the guy who admits to killing his neighbor and chopping him up and throwing him in the river. He's free, man. Oh, we can't do better than that? Oh, we'll never top that. No machine could ever top that. Are you kidding me? What is this? Why are we so married to this? Let's just move forward. Don't we just move forward with everything?
No.
Why not? We use instant replay in the NFL. We understand that humans make mistakes and we have this technology and we utilize technology. Isn't that what we do? Let's just do it for this. And this machine doesn't know what color you are, and it doesn't know what your sexual proclivity is. It doesn't know anything. All it knows is how you register. You either pass or you don't. Better. Better than trying to get the jury, oh, there's not enough blacks on it, there's not enough women on it, there's not enough Latinos on it. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
You'd be, the innocent have, and please, you idiots are always with these conspiracy things about, oh, it's going to get rigged. Yeah, what's in it for us as a society just to rig the machine? Yeah, that's what we want. We want all the innocent taxpayers going in the joint. That's what we want. That's what the man wants. He wants the innocent behind bars and criminals out there paying taxes.
Think about the conspiracy theories there have been and the number of conspiracies that have actually been.
Yeah, where are they?
Next caller!
Where is it? Where's Roswell? Where's Kennedy? Where's the second gun? Where's the alien autopsy?
How about
what
the,
about it?
The Bermuda Triangle and the
Listen,
devil.
Let me say something about conspiracies
caller,
in this country. We've been trying to get Castro out of there for about 70 years. Nothing. He's smoking cigars and banging hookers and laughing at us. It's been we've gone through seven or eight administrations while he's been sitting there laughing his ass off. Okay, we've been trying to kill Saddam Hussein. We've been trying to kill Bin Laden. We can't do anything. What do you mean conspiracies? What, name us something we can do?
Right, in an organized way.
Nobody knows. Don't you think? Let's just put it this way. If we could do things in a conspiratorial way that we thought would be effective, I don't know if conspiratorial. A conspiratorial way that was effective, don't you think Castro would have been dead about 45 years ago?
Of course.
What would Bin Laden been doing? You know, all this things like, hey, man, the CIA, they have secret death squads we don't even know about. Don't you think we would have got rid of these guys that we want to get rid of many years ago instead of just wasting all our time and resources hiking around with camels looking for them now? If we could just snap our fingers and kill anyone whenever we want with a total impunity and nobody knows about it, what's Bin Laden doing alive? What's Castro doing alive? No, we can't do anything. We can't get any kind of conspiracy going. Don't you guys watch 60 Minutes? Nothing works.
We can't even get a consensus amongst the tards and the jury.
Ugh. Let's just get this one machine going, and that's that.
All right. Let's get this show going, and that's that.
What do you
mean?
Let's
save some babies.
Oh. How dare you.
Carrie.
Hi.
Hey.
Okay. So this is, like, so embarrassing, but my coochie feels like it's on fire.
My machine could solve this.
And you know what? If it keeps me from having to go to a doctor and having somebody touch me, I'd be there.
That's where my dogs come in.
Yes. This is moving forward. Go ahead. Adam's disgusted.
Tired.
You're disgusted.
I'm wasting my breath with all my good ideas and all you.
Oh, and by the way, Adam, I love you. You're my most favorite atheist in the entire world. You make me laugh even when I want to.
Shay, it's all other atheists.
Thank you.
Yeah, Carrie, you never had a pelvic exam?
No, I have. I hated it every
single like
time.
Him. Like, gets, just, yeah, maybe you have a yeast infection. Any discharge with this?
See, I don't know, because, like, it's either a yeasty beastie, which I don't know how I could get that, but, like...
You can get that just by being a female and being alive.
Well, I've only ever had one of those in my entire life, and that was when I had my first girlfriend, so...
girlfriend.
Yeah. What happened? Bad, polluted strap-on?
Bad... Beastie.
Well, did she? You're snatchy watchy?
Well, I guess I didn't really know what was raunchy and what wasn't.
By the way, it's raunchy wonchy.
So, like, okay.
Well, but seriously, did she use a vibrator on you?
No. See, like, I haven't had sex for like 3 years.
Hmm.
So, but like, I've used a vibrator like really, really kind of a lot and really kind of harsh like a week ago.
Hold on a second. Let me come back.
Yeah, sidebar. Yeah.
Carrie's like 10 kinds of nuts.
Yes, ma'am.
She's calling from Utah, too.
Mm hmm.
Something happened. She was raped with a Bible or something.
Yeah.
You know,
beaten with a Bible, I think.
No, if you use the paperback ones, you can roll them up.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. It's an easier read, by the way, too.
Are you a Mormon?
No, I am so anti Mormon, it's not even funny.
Uh oh.
Were you
at
one time?
What happened?
Okay, evil brother, evil Mormons, enough said.
What's your evil brother? Sexual molestation?
Years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice.
By your evil Mormon brother?
Yeah.
Oh, that's good.
Well,
you Mormon?
He wasn't even Mormon. Like, I don't know. My whole family's just kind of special.
Special.
But, like, yeah, I had, like, the evil Mormon neighbors that would tell on me when I would try to, like, go home from church early. Oh, Carrie left church early today. Was she sick? And then, like, my parents would just get all totally, you know, evil on me and blah, blah, blah. So,
what would they do when they were being evil?
Well, no, like, they just, I'd get in, like, major trouble, and then, like, I'd have to, like, next time I'd be at church, and, like, they'd have to, like, watch me the entire time, and I don't know, they'd have to have, like, they're just...
Now, Dad, she's working herself over the library.
You're paying Dad back.
Yeah,
it's just, it's stupid. Like, the Mormon thing's not even nearly as bad as the other stuff, so, but, like, yeah, no, I am doing, like, the therapy thing, though. So.
Good, there we go.
All right, just stick with that.
Yeah, and, like, I take the pills and the whole nine yards. And,
what medicine are you taking? Depakote.
I have a nice little cocktail. It's
Depakote.
Ritalin.
Oh, Ritalin.
No, actually, Depakote doesn't really do anything for me. But it's trazodone for sleep and Seroquel and Topamax.
Yeah.
Type 2 bipolar rapid
treatment.
Right. Imagine that.
Hey. Ooh.
Need to jack up that Seroquel a bit or switch over to Zyprexa.
Actually, I can't take too much because lately it just makes me fall asleep at work. And if I'm not like boom, 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 boom at work, I'm just nothing.
Maybe Zyprexa.
What are you doing? You work with kids?
No, I work in accounting. God, no, I don't work with people.
You a Mormon?
Good. Christ.
And I'm lesbian, so thank God I'll never have kids because I can't ever have a child. Let's screw them up. I have cats.
Good.
Listen, we like you, Carrie. We
like you. Anybody who is effed up, announces they're effed up, and then says, I don't want to F up any kids.
Saint.
Genius.
Saint.
Saintious. All right.
Genius.
Let me ask you this.
Hey, well, I'm not done with Carrie, but go ahead.
Right.
Go ahead. Ask me.
She
probably just said, you go get over-the-counter use medication. There's tons out there. Take it. See if it goes away. If it doesn't, then you have to get an exam. It could be other things.
All right.
There you go.
I can get some pliers.
What do you want to ask?
Well, they have these, every radio station I've ever worked at has had these sort of adjustable mic stand things that are just a piece of S, which is, well, no, it's cantilevering arm and a spring mechanism, and it's a gimbal system, and so theoretically, you can adjust it 170 different ways and dial it in so the mic is exactly where you want it, as long as you want it exactly where it settles each and every time and there's nothing you can do about it. Now, there's
a little nostalgia for the old Westwood One studio, Adam. We used to lean back with those mic on those crappy stands.
I'm still trying to tighten the thing. Yeah, I'm still waiting for someone to torch that dump, by the way. Really am. Mm. Yeah,
don't
be nice.
Incite anything.
Yeah, and don't incite it. Mm. Yeah, it'd be worth it to collect on the insurance. Vanessa?
Yeah?
You're 20?
Yeah.
What's up?
I was just wondering how I could get my boyfriend to go down on me without me having to go down on him at the same time.
Same time?
Like 69ing.
Oh.
Have you asked him to?
Oh, yeah.
And what does he say?
Together for 3 years.
And what does he say?
Not right now. No, thanks. Maybe later.
Maybe later. And by the way.
what is that?
Who 69's 3 years in the relationship?
We've been doing it ever since the beginning.
Are you not having sex?
Oh, yeah. We have sex all the time.
I know you've been doing...
He just asked why this hasn't run out of steam. Why do you continue to do something that people sort of...
Yeah, you're 69 at the beginning. You knock that down to like a 53. And then it works down to like, I'm into the minus now.
Because I stopped going down on him for a month and a half.
Why?
In hopes that he would... Get the clue.
And, I said because I was doing it like three or four times a week.
This sounds like a horrible relationship.
Yeah, you too. You're done. Three years. You were together since 17.
Yeah.
That's it. You're done.
I'm engaged and I have a baby.
Oh. All right. Well, that's just.
And we own a house together.
Own a house or somebody's grandma committed suicide?
No. We worked very hard.
69ing or is there other forms of income? What do you mean? You're 20 years old. How old's your kid?
She's going to be a year pretty soon.
Where's all your bacon been coming in? You got a one-year-old? You were pregnant a year before that?
I worked two jobs for quite a while, and
quite a while.
Look, she got a one-year-old.
Yeah.
A newborn, essentially, or 1 year old, and then was pregnant for the year before that. She's 20 now. How many years in the salt mine could she have logged to save up the money for the house?
In Canada, they take care of their own. She's from British Columbia. They have ultra inexpensive housing in certain areas.
All right. Maybe that's it. Vanessa?
Yeah?
Do you have any of that subsidized housing? Is that what you're doing?
Nope.
How much did the house cost?
$93,700.
And
hey, we haven't paid it off yet.
No, I know, but you got your, what is your, what's your boyfriend do? Your fiance?
He's a fish farmer.
Fish farmer?
Yeah.
He owns the fish farm?
No.
And what did you do?
He works. I worked at IGA and,
Oh, you're over at IGA?
Over at IGA, over on West, Second Street.
The grocery store. And I worked at Quiznos.
Quiznos. That's where the bucks come from.
You worked at a chain sub sandwich place?
Yep.
And that's where you got the bucks to buy the house because you were there for nine and a half months?
In a country where the tax level is 80%?
We saved quite a bit of money pretty quick. We're really good like that.
Listen, I don't care if you crapped rolls of quarters. You couldn't save enough money working at Quiznos in a year and a half to buy a house.
We only needed $5,000.
Wow. I'm moving to Canada. Is British Columbia in Canada?
Yeah.
I'm moving to Canada. All right, baby doll. I don't like this guy.
Why?
But you got to make it work. Because he's not being considerate for you. He's not willing to accommodate and be considerate. And you've been a little bit aggressive, I must admit.
You're a little angry? Where's Daddy?
My dad?
Yeah.
He's in town, but...
You don't like him?
Oh, no, I love my dad, but he's...
Boozer?
Yeah. He just finally started working again after like 9 or 10 years.
Where's my bourbon?
He's over at Quiznos, too. Okay, so your dad's an alcoholic and you have some
He was an alcoholic. Well, he is an alcoholic, yes.
Okay.
Is he in recovery now? No.
Pardon?
No.
How's the fish? How's Mr. Paul?
Mr. Paul.
That's the fish guy.
I know. It's Mrs. Paul, but he's Mr. Paul.
Right. Yeah.
All right, here we go.
All right, Vanessa, listen, take care of that kid. Look. And look, listen, everyone, don't get into that barter for sex.
Yeah, it's passive aggressive.
Well, listen, I'm going to stop blowing you if you don't start going down on me.
Yeah.
Or I'm going to blow you for 10 minutes. You got to go down on me for at least 8 minutes. You know, all that stuff.
But you could say, look, our physical relationship is not working for me. You don't seem to be listening to me at all. I'm not interested right now. And then kind of say, look, I need you to be hearing me when I ask for certain things. And now, don't be depriving completely. Don't withhold sex. That's, you know, gets awfully aggressive. People get angry. Find a way to talk about it. There's no magic. You ask the question, how do I get him to do that? No, there's no sort of, you know what I mean? There's no sort of magic formula for that.
But listen, please listen to me, kiddies. This is why you don't hook up and go long-term at 17, 18, 19. I know she's 20 now, but, you know, this is why you don't spit out a kid, get pregnant at 18. You're dating a fish farmer. You know what I mean? You're 20. You're an idiot. You're an idiot at 20. You don't know anything. The opposite sex is, it's just some sort of adversarial robot that you feel you have to beat into submission, you know? You don't know about...
Your seed.
It's just you're angry at them. Why can't he do this? All you do... And then you spit out a kid and you just torture the kid and we slowly poison the planet.
There you go.
All right, but...
But we're going to bring a machine... Oh, yeah, go ahead.
On a brighter side...
Yes.
Brenna, who's 18, huge boobs, 34, double F.
Bouncy, bouncy.
Again, double F?
Bouncy, bouncy.
Not a G.
She's tiny. She wants to know about getting them reduced. Wait till kids. Uh-oh, baby voice. Hold on. Brenna?
Hi.
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 All right, let's figure out your dimensions real quick now.
Sorry, I'm really nervous.
That's all right. I'm starting to get nervous too. What's that?
Because I'm in love with you.
Okay.
Okay, hold on.
All right, hold on.
Hold on a second.
Hold on. Hold on. You're out in Cyprus?
Yeah.
You got a car?
Actually, you know what? Me and my friend wanted to come visit you today.
Uh-huh.
And we didn't know
today?
Where the studio was
tonight?
Located.
Oh, okay. Well, you probably can't drive with that rack of yours.
Well, no? My friend's the one who's driving.
Okay, hold on a second.
You're right, you can't drive.
Yeah. 18, huge rack. 34 double F. And again, you want that low first number and then the low letter after that.
Right.
Right. All right. We'll get back to Brennan right after this.
Hello. This is your radio. LoveLine will be right back.
Hey, everybody. It's LoveLine. I'm Adam. This Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191.
Boy, Adam, those almonds would be good. Smokehouse almonds.
I can't crack that can because...
There's plenty there for the enema afterwards.
No, I need them all for my almond enema. I got a nice fresh can of Blue Diamond Smokehouse almonds. Let me say this too. Oh, what? A guy sends me over $1.99 worth of almonds. I'm supposed to give him a plug on the air.
Just his name,
Steve.
Okay, that's it.
All right, thanks, Steve. Sending over 50 cents worth of almonds. Supposed to give the guy's company a shout out.
No. Just the
name. No, I want to thank Steve for sending over these Blue Diamond almonds. And I want to thank Blue Diamond in advance for sending over a case. Now, listen.
Yeah.
I want to take these almonds rectally. I want to liquefy them. I want to fill a...
you want a paste. You don't want them liquefied.
I like them. I like the sort of the consistency of maybe...
pudding.
More 30 weight oil.
Okay, yeah. Okay.
I want it viscous, but not like water.
Right.
Okay?
Yeah, you want to be able to hold it.
And then I want put it in one of those pastry bags. Yeah. And I want you to work it into me until you see it coming out of my nose.
Your nose.
That's how I want to die. I want to die of smoked. You understand? But let me say this. And we got to get back to Brennan with the huge boobs.
Yeah.
And tell me if you have this problem with the snacking industry. Little too much of whatever it is. Little too salty. Too much.
Of course.
Here's the thing about the smoked almonds. You can have a handful of them, and then after that, I go wash them off. I go put them under the sink.
Oh, really?
Too salty, too pasty, too much junk.
I've seen you go through quite a few of these without.
No. You got to wash them, or you got to take a slug of water, beer, or something in between every night. I'm saying this way with the barbecue flavoring and all. It's what? Just back off on that stuff, everybody. If they dialed this this down just 20-30%, you'd be in good shape, right?
Yeah, they need to have the Corolla.
I got a new flavoring theory. I think the dumber you are, the saltier you like your snacks.
Mm-hmm.
Stupid people like salt.
Salt and sugar. Carbohydrate.
But they're like cows, right?
Yeah.
They're like a salt lick.
Mm-hmm.
Stupid people, we should just give them a salt lick. They can just lick it.
They have them in the jewelry boxes.
Oh. I'm not going tomorrow.
I wouldn't if I were.
Screw it. No. $1,500. I'm a millionaire. Literally a millionaire. Brenna?
Hi.
You're 18.
That's not even one of those caissons.
No.
Yeah.
You're 18. You're 34 double F.
Yeah, it's actually...
How do you know you're 34 double F?
How do I know? Is that what you said?
Yeah.
Well, I didn't know. Actually, I thought I was a D, like a 34 D. Mm-hmm. And then, like, me and my mom, like, Nordstrom's had some sort of breast cancer awareness thing. And, like, all the Ds were, like, kind of small. And they measured me, and I found out I was a 34 double F.
Bouncy.
It was really shocking, actually.
Yeah. What's the rest of you? What's the rest of you there?
I don't know. Like, I don't...
Well,
like,
how tall are you? How tall are you?
I'm like 5'3 and a half. I'm not
five,
lying. I know you have your radio math theory.
5'3 and a half. No, I'm fine. And how much you weigh?
About like 135.
Mm-hmm.
I'm really muscly, though, I guess.
Hold on. How do you get the 34 part if you're short and muscular? Doesn't that make you a little more broad around the back?
No, like my legs are really buff and like my butt and stuff.
All right, well.
Not my upper body.
Hold on a second. Like I got a strategy. She can keep her sweats on.
All right.
All right, Brenna.
Hi.
What, big areolas?
I think they're proportionate. Like I wouldn't.
All right,
that
means they're size of hubcaps.
They're not the size of hubcaps.
Right. All right, so what's the problem, baby doll?
Who's number one?
Yeah, the Minka's number one. That's it.
Well, it's just like they're just so like I don't have any problems with my back. Like my back doesn't hurt or anything yet, but it's just they get in the way, and they make like they ruin my posture. Like I slouch a lot, and I don't know. Like a lot of people tease me, but I kind of got over that. I guess like I just ignore it.
Right. Listen, all the greats were teased in high school.
Well, I'm a freshman in college. Actually.
Socrates. Oh. Junior college?
It's my first semester.
Junior college.
How dare you, Adam?
Well, what else is in Cyprus?
Yeah.
Okay, yes, junior college.
Yeah, okay. All right, that's fine. Now, look, that's fine.
I'm still embarrassed because I know how you feel about that.
No, not for you.
Oh, not for me?
That's right. I don't mind that.
Okay.
All right.
And I also want, well, the problem is that I don't know if I'm still growing or not, and I really, like, want to look into breast reduction, but I'm not sure if I should wait until, like, after I have kids, because I'm sure they'll get even bigger, unfortunately.
Or sometimes they atrophy after kids. They shrink way down.
Where do you graduate junior college in another 13 years? It's a 2-year program, Joe.
Of course.
Listen, Brenna.
Yes.
Do you have a boyfriend?
No, I don't.
Why not?
I'm actually very picky, so I don't have a boyfriend, but I'm in love with you.
All right. I'm in love with you
year,
now.
I wanted to call you and invite you to my prom, but then I found out you got married. I was really upset.
Yeah, my old lady's cool with that.
Oh, yeah, your old lady's cool.
Me and remember the time I went to the Grammy with the Dixie chick?
Oh, she was very cool.
Yeah, I heard about that, and I heard about the prank she played on you.
No, that wasn't her prank.
It wasn't her prank. That was Jimmy's prank.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've been listening to you since I was 12.
Oh, man, I bet you were just a D-cup back then.
Yeah, I was just a D-cup back then.
All right, well, listen here, baby doll.
Mm-hmm.
You're 18. You could consult with a plastic surgeon.
It's
just a little preliminary. Get that they're not going to charge anything, right?
Many of them don't. Many of them don't. Some do.
But you find one that doesn't, and just get a consultation, see what their professional opinion is.
Cyprus, isn't that down by Seal Beach where Dr. Marcel is?
Oh, Dr. Marcel.
Dr. Marcel is in Seal Beach?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, he's
is that Seal Beach?
Well, I think Dr. Marcel is out there. Maybe go check out Dr. Marcel.
Yeah, I heard him on LoveLine. He's not as interesting as Drew.
No, he is not, but he does wear a gold pinky ring, and he does feel a kind of freedom in the nude that we could only dream about.
Oh, really?
Oh, yes. Yes, he feels free when he's nude.
Nice. We're looking for a new call screener as well.
Oh, Engineer Anderson says we're... Oh, you heard him.
To be a call screener.
All right, well, let's see.
It would be my dream come true to work.
All right, well, let's try. Let's do a little... because Tara, don't call me Tara, moved on to greener pastures.
She stopped working.
Yeah, she's touring the Middle East with the princess of...
somewhere.
Of
Saudi Arabia?
Yeah, Saudi Arabia or something. Oh, my God. All right, just let's try this a second, all right, Brenna?
Okay.
I'll be one of the people who call the show.
Okay,
you ready?
Yeah.
Hi. My name's Douchebag, and I got a... Florida or Tokyo.
I would hang up on him.
Yeah.
All right, Brandon, you're in.
Yeah.
Looking for the good caller. That's nice.
Looking for the good caller.
Yeah, I know what you like, Adam.
All right. Well, maybe you'd be a phone screener.
I would love to be a phone screener.
All right.
It would seriously be my dream come true. Today, me and my friend wanted to drive down there and visit you, and we called the K-Rock studio, and the guy hung up on us.
Yeah. Well, he's been fired.
I took care
of him. He's as good as gone, baby. All right. I'm going to need you to come down here tomorrow morning. We'll do a voice lineup.
Oh, I have to work.
All right. Where do you work?
I work at... whatever. Okay.
Quiznos?
I work at the Sunglass Hut.
Ooh. Hold on a second. That is such a connection. True. I mean, sunglasses. Yeah. Good pair of shades. $100, $110. And I lose those things,
I was going to say,
too.
You just go
sit
through
on
them every couple of weeks.
Yeah.
I will still hook you up.
You could steal, right?
What?
You can be set up with some Wayfarers or something?
I'll hook you up better than that. I'll hook you up with the best glasses we carry.
Yeah. I like the aviators. I just don't like the wire ones because, you know, I sit on them and...
Oh, really?
All right. We'll put you on hold. You talk to Anderson. See if so we can get you as a phone screener. Makes sense. And listen, let me explain something, though, from what I can gather here at LoveLine. It's very stringent
screening
procedure. Here's what you have to do. You have to show up first, right? And you must not have fecal matter smeared on any body part that we can at least see. And then you're in, right?
You must be able to get coffee for Anna.
Yes, yes. Although she won't be here.
Yeah,
she'll be back at Westwood, too.
Yeah, she won't be able to stay away from you, though.
Carrie?
Yeah.
She'll come here first and give you your coffee and then go do the screening job.
I'll tell you, the big lower half part was scaring me, Drew. I got to be honest with you.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You felt so guilty you had to offer her a job.
Yeah. What's happening, Carrie?
I got Florida or Germany. Or Germany. Right.
It's Germany or Florida, but go ahead.
But Anderson's busy talking to Brandon now, so we don't get the theme song.
That's all right. Go ahead.
Well, yeah, okay.
I wanted Tori's theme song. Wait a minute. No, we want to hear Tori's.
He's got to get it together.
Yeah.
There is technical difficulties. I'm going to have to pull it over the weekend.
Yeah.
I'm going to have to come in over the weekend to pull it, but I will.
All right. I may be doing some pulling over the weekend, too. Go ahead, Carrie.
Yeah. A 42-year-old man killed himself watching the total solar eclipse while driving. A witness saw the man weaving back and forth as he concentrated on the partially occluded sun. Suddenly, he accelerated and hit the bridge pier. He had apparently just donned his solar viewers, which are dark enough to totally obscure everything except the sun.
Oh, my God.
Oh, I That's see. Florida. So he's wearing like a welding mask. It's a bridge pier.
Florida.
We're going Florida.
No, it's Germany.
Oh, busted.
Moated.
That was the most... We've missed it. That was the we were completely out of line on that one.
Yeah. You know, let me tell you something. And good job there, Kerry. You know what happened, Drew?
Mm.
We got cocky.
Yeah.
We lost our edge.
Yeah.
We lost the eye of the tiger.
All right, let's try it again.
Real quick now. Sarah?
Yeah.
Germany or Florida? Go ahead.
All right, a short, dumpy man has been going around faking choking episodes to get attention from women. He flails his arms, coughs, sputters, and when a woman...
Adam, I told you they're going to catch on to this someday.
Yeah. Yeah, that's it.
When a woman rushes over to help, he showers her with gratitude, hugs, and kisses. The authorities can't do anything because technically he's not committing any crimes, and no one's really been hurt except for one woman who went to the hospital with an anxiety attack.
with a cootie attack.
That sounds boy, Germany. Sounds to me. Germany yeah. too. But here's the thing: the authorities can't do anything. It seems like in Germany they
do something, and people don't get panic attacks. Go to the emergency room in Germany. You know, that's an American thing.
Man,
right?
We've never been 0-2 in the annals of Germany or Florida. The history of Germany and Florida never 0-2 start.
Florida.
Florida.
It is Florida.
Okay, oh, now we're back.
Christ!
We're back.
Yeah!
All right.
Yeah! High five, Drew. Yeah! All right.
Oh,
hey, that was a good save, man.
But really, it shattered our confidence. You see that? We were weak.
Got second guessing, but you know what?
We had momentum.
But like any great champion, we got up off the canvas in the later rounds.
We did. No, we made it.
Got
we're
up.
Back. We're
All
good.
Right, we're
yeah.
back. We're back, and we'll be back after this. LoveLine. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Drew saw the Haunted Mansion movie tonight.
No, not tonight. Last weekend.
Last weekend?
Yeah.
That thing's
You're
out
gay.
Already?
Yeah.
Poor kids dragging you everywhere.
Oh, yeah.
Well, shouldn't you balance it out by dragging them to see some porn?
No. I usually dump them off in the theater and then I go watch what I want to watch. But I kind of wanted to watch it. It looked interesting. And then,
here'd be a good policy to institute with the kids.
Yeah.
Like they go, we want to see, we want to see the Olsen twins. We want to see the Cat in the Hat. And you go, all right. And, next weekend we see Taxi Driver with Daddy. And we're going to see Pepillon. We're going to watch, Serpico. Yeah. We're going to watch Boxing Elena.
No,
and then they're like, okay, they would do it. They go, I don't care, Dad. We'll go see Cat in the Hat. We'll go. Then they'd be horrified watching your movie. And then the next weekend would roll around and they'd go, we want to see the Haunted Mansion. And then you'd go, that's good because Daddy's got Barry Lyndon. He's got the 5-CD disc set of Barry Lyndon. It's a 9-hour movie. You guys like Albert Finney? Does everyone know? You don't know who he is. And they'd go, all right, Daddy, well, what's a movie you want? And then you pick your intermediate movie. You end up seeing the pirate movie or something like that. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's good. Huh? Yeah.
How about that?
I went to see them to see Master Commander. I like that film.
Yeah, and there's kids in it, your kids' age, practically.
Yeah.
There's nothing wrong with that. There's no language or any little violence, but nothing any more than half the cartoons they're watching and the video games they're playing. Get a little education. Yeah? Maybe give them a love for the sea. Maybe they could put out, you know? They
put out to sea.
Put out to sea. You never know. Your kids could turn 18 and put out.
Yes, it could.
Put out. Eric?
Yeah.
You're 20?
Yeah.
What's up?
Hey, how you doing, man?
Good.
Hey, I got a little question for Dr. Drew.
All right, Eric.
Hey, Dr. Drew.
Yeah.
Hey, I heard you can tell if a woman is orgasming based on whether, like, lower pelvic area is contracting. I guess it's, like, some hormonal thing. And, like, if they're not contracting, you know, you can tell they're lying. Is that true?
Eric, the vagina will contract with... You know how your penis contracts when the stuff coming out of it during an orgasm?
Yeah.
They have the same contractions, and it brings the vaginal wall in around your penis a little bit. You can feel that. But guess what? They can do that volitionally, too, just the way you can kind of make your penis hop up and down by constricting those muscles.
Mm-hmm.
They can do the same. Cool. They can do the same thing.
Yeah.
What a bunch of jerks. All right, well, yeah. That's cool. Hey, Dr. Drew, how old are your kids?
11.
Oh, you know what? Just to cure your curiosity, when I was 11, I was beating off all of the time, buddy.
Yep, so that's what I keep telling them.
I gotta go
kill myself.
I tell him 9, though.
11 is a little precocious, Eric, but yeah. 12 is when some can kick in.
Really?
Yeah.
And let's not forget, Drew, you're a man of exquisite passion.
All those genes are getting passed on.
Your wife is a passionate woman, too.
Mm.
That's a... two passionate gene pools that are flowing into the same pond.
You know how kids
same
are.
Same passion
the kids
pond.
Are. They want to do the opposite of their parents.
Yeah, I know. Like for me, it was like work and own a house.
And masturbate.
Oh, I guess so.
Yeah, see?
Yeah.
Your parents weren't exactly passionate.
I think my dad would have beat off if he could have done it using telepathy. But his problem was it involved movement.
It required, motoric movement. Yes.
And movement technically was something. And he wasn't going to do anything. So you're catch 22 when you announce you'll never do anything.
Right.
All right. Why are we here, Drew?
Isabel.
Isabel?
Yep.
You're 21?
Yes.
What's up?
I should start from the beginning. About almost a year ago, I was with this guy, and we were having sex, and he took the condom off, and I didn't notice it till afterwards, and he gave me herpes.
Nice.
He had an outbreak at that moment?
It's like, well, with herpes, you know, it's like you don't really know for sure who gave it to you.
Right.
You know? What's that?
He might not have known he had it. I doubt he had an active outbreak.
Right. I'm not saying he did it intentionally.
Okay.
That's not.
How did he take the condom off without you knowing it?
Because if you move positions and he pulls out, then the lights are off and you can't see it. And what made me notice it afterwards was that the lights came back on and I looked at the condom and it was empty. And then he insisted that we take a shower. And
maybe he didn't ejaculate.
Hold on a second. Jizz McGruff.
Sherlock.
Now, all I'm saying is he may have given you herpes, but it doesn't... You're innocent until proven guilty in this country until my machine comes out.
So anyways, that's how I got, or I think I got it.
But let me ask you this.
Okay.
He took the condom off and it was empty.
Right.
Didn't he have an orgasm?
Yes, he did. But that's what I'm saying. It was off before he did.
But wouldn't you have noticed him having the orgasm?
No, I know he did.
He took it off before he orgasmed.
I know. Then where's his argument part come in?
That's not the important part.
Maybe he had oral herpes. Did he give you oral sex?
No.
Bastard.
Yeah. All right, anyway.
I know. I had a boyfriend recently, and we had sex before I could tell him, and he ended up getting it.
Yeah.
And I didn't.
How does that work? Did you have sex before you could tell him?
Well,
did he gag you or
what's that?
Tennis ball in your mouth? And
I'm sorry.
I listened. She was nervous. And
it's like it's not that easy to come right out and tell someone. So, anyways, I gave it to him and I never told him the truth about it. And so, but that's in the past. And now my problem is that I started dating this guy. And we fooled around a little bit, but at this point, I don't ever want to give it to somebody again unless they're aware of what's going on.
Of their risks, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And so now I'm seeing this guy. I really like him, and I'm kind of wondering how I go about telling him that I have it.
Drew, what about it?
I think you just come right out.
First off, okay, how about this? How about a little two-phase lie? Single-phase lie.
All right.
You say, I have herpes. Don't get in that whole story. I was banging this guy and he pulled the condom off. And this
No.
Just do look. Say you got it from gym towel or something,
or whatever.
Make up a little BS.
But he's got. Okay. She's got it.
Yeah, she got it. But I'm telling you, for some reason, it'll make him feel better.
Okay, if you didn't get it from sex, I had it my. My mouth, wipe my mouth with a towel.
All you got to do is use a sweaty towel, bad sock,
right,
gym
but
class,
be that
whatever.
As it may, he can wear a condom and protect himself. If you're not feeling an outbreak, you could take antiviral medication, decrease the risk of exposing him to the virus.
Okay.
The things you can do, and so many people have this thing that I think young people, if they're going to have sex, have to realize that there's a certain amount of risk. They got to protect themselves the best they can. And
You got to go see a doctor, see about getting on some of that suppressive medication.
Yeah,
man.
That'd be good.
It's great stuff, too. You've seen the commercial.
You start the kickboxing.
Yeah. Kickboxing all day long. That's what the chicks do. They become empowered now, so they stomp a little ass. A little herpy ass. All right, we'll take a quick break. We'll be right back.
Love Line. With Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew. 1105 Alternative. San Francisco.
Love Line, I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Drew, don't feel like Thursday, does it?
No, it's a funny night. I've got to do a satellite tour in the morning.
Ugh.
No, not in the morning. In about 4 hours.
Ugh.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Well, it's worth it to sell a book and a half.
Yeah.
Getting up at 3:45 in the morning. Ugh. Listen, please, I'm thinking about not going to jury duty tomorrow. Somebody please call me and tell me what I can expect and how, I mean.
There's some
office I'm going to be a fugitive.
Yeah, manages this.
What if I fake,
fake your death? Fake an illness?
Uh-huh. Note from the doctor.
They'll want a record.
That's
and
gold.
They'll reschedule you. I rescheduled 3 times last time.
Listen.
They're very good about rescheduling.
I don't care. That note from the doctor is gold, baby.
No, I'm telling you, it doesn't
spun
mean crap.
Gold.
First of all, they're
quit
getting
with
hardcore
the
about
and make
I'm
with
telling
the
you, I write these things.
Make me a note.
They want a medical record.
Fine. Do that too. Do it all. I want them to think I'm limbless.
Then you have to go in and reschedule.
Well, then we got to remove limbs. Let's just get me a note going. Give me a nice note. Dear sirs, start with sirs. Sirs or ma'ams. Dear sirs or ma'ams. And then just go on to say that dear Sams, I have a condition that does not permit me to judge. Lest ye not judge. Be judged ye self.
You're going to be a conscientious objector of jury duty.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Judge not.
Lest ye be judged.
Yes, you have to go to jury duty.
That's right. I don't judge. I don't believe it's any man can judge another or culture.
Because it's all the same.
And it's all the same.
It's all beautiful.
Well, listen, you know, like if you're in a culture that mutilates your young daughter's vagina, for instance, wax off the clitoris or something, we can't judge.
Of course not.
We can't judge.
It's cultural. How dare you?
It's a cultural thing.
How dare you?
If you want your women to wear a pillowcase over their head, you can beat them with a rock if they ever show their face around any males or something. Can we judge?
It's beautiful. How dare you?
I don't know if it's beautiful or not, but we can't judge.
I can't judge whether it's beautiful or not beautiful. You're right. It's just
we
is.
Can't judge.
Just is.
You know, one of those cultures where you F your own kids, can't judge. Cannot judge. Haven't we learned our lesson? Drew, have we not learned our lesson? We cannot judge.
No.
Any good Democrat knows you can't judge. You can't judge. These are cultural things. See what I'm saying?
I hear you.
All right. So, guy steals a 10-speed or stabs his old lady. Can I judge?
How?
It's part of it. Could be part of his culture.
Or religion, even.
Or religion. They have their ways. I have mine. I can't judge. Thank you.
Remember the separation of church and state.
That's
they're violating that by making you sit in judgment of this man's
That's
religion.
That's right.
How dare you?
We've all learned valuable lessons over the last few months about world events, and we know that we can't judge. We can't judge, Drew. Penny?
Oh, hello.
Yeah, there's no better or worse. There's only different, right? Corny you ACLU fags.
Me?
We can't judge. Go ahead, Penny.
Oh, okay. Oh, I have a way you can get out of jury.
How?
Okay. Well, my parents' friend do this, and they hate him for it, but he tells them that he has no way to get there. He has no transportation, which is a complete lie. Ooh. He has his own car, but they buy it every time.
Really?
Yeah. And I
Drew, write me a note that says I have no car. All right, now I got Drew. I'm going to get a note now.
Yeah.
Go ahead, Penny.
Okay. This is going to come out really... Well, anyway, I'll just read it. I'm lonely as all heck, but I'm too disgusted with everyone I meet to settle for one of them. Am I just reading them all, or meeting the wrong people, or are my standards too high? And how do I fix it?
Mm-hmm.
Being disgusted is sort of a strong emotion.
Yeah, but and, I really am.
And it kind of suggests that there's something there, because not everyone is disgusting.
No, not disgusting, like, gross. Just, you know, the little things, the quirks that people have, and as a friend, you're just supposed to get used to it and love them despite it. I can't to do that.
Yeah, when you can't, it's because you don't want to. You don't you don't have a, you're not so much, you don't have, it's a volitional thing. It's just you're not going to let yourself. So you can't have a close relationship because you're kept away by these persistent
self-fulfilling destiny.
Yeah, of course. So what happened? Why is intimacy so problematic for you?
Well, for relationships, well, first of all, I've been smothered the whole time I was raised because I'm an only child and my parents are overprotective. And
okay, so so one of the fantasies, the sort of the implicit fears that people have when they come out of those sorts of family systems is that they're going to be consumed by the relationship, overcome, you know, that yourself is going to be somehow subjugated to the other person.
Me, I know how you feel, because me and my sister were both only
smothered,
children.
They were smothered.
No, we're... Oh, Drew, you stepped on my good joke.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Jackass.
And
especially also, me and my sister were both only child. You know, so,
and I've only...
I'll write it down. I'll say it another time.
Okay.
Go ahead.
I've only had one relationship, really, before. And it turned out to be a neo-Nazi, so...
Interesting.
Yeah.
Well, we can't judge.
Yeah.
Can't judge. Different culture.
Yeah.
So it's interesting. People that are nice, you find reasons to pick on them. You know, pick nits. And somebody that is a sort of a horrible human.
We can't judge.
I didn't know he was a Nazi.
That's the point.
Yeah.
You didn't know that he's the person that would be a neo-Nazi.
Bad antenna.
Right.
So wait, your parents were overprotective, but they were loving, right?
No.
My mom works constantly, but my dad is a writer, so he got to stay home and
kind of alcoholic, like, nut job.
No, neither of them drink.
What do you write? Well, what kind of writer doesn't drink? He couldn't have been any good.
Takes out his bitterness on me.
That's what I'm talking about. What's the bitterness?
Oh, just constant complaining and letting off steam. And
what kind of writing did he do?
Nonfiction and also historical fiction. He's trying to get a book published about the Klondike. But regularly he works for our local newspaper,
boring.
Magazine.
About the Klondike?
Yeah, it's
like a gold rush.
Yeah, it's the
ice cream sandwich.
How can you call yourself a writer if you've never had a book published?
No, he's had books published.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he's written a couple travel guides for San Diego, and he's written a couple of children's books.
Oh, well, that's Pulitzer Prize material there. Travel guides. Screw him.
What is the bitterness you're talking about? What does he complain about?
Oh, well, for instance, right now we live in this pretty small condo, and every day he gets into his conversation, I hate it here so much, blah 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 blah.
But he's a genius, and he should be be acknowledging that.
All right, let me say this first off, Penny.
Okay.
Travel guides to San Diego and writer's books, the biggest cop out a writer can ever do. They all suck, those writers, those children's books. Madonna writes them, for Christ's sake. Every idiot writes a child. Screw those children's books. That's a cop out. That's like, you know what it's like? Here's who should write children's books. Children. Because here's what it's like. It's like you are entering the Special Olympics. That's, I won the 100. Well, what was your time? 15 minutes. What was the second best? And 22 minutes. Blind guy who had half a leg. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's stupid children's books. Can't stand that. All right, Kobe, listen. She's got to get out of that house. She's 18. She's living in a little condo with a bitter writer dad. Mm-hmm. Nothing's worse. You got a dad who writes travel guides to San Diego.
But he's one of those guys, he's too smart. The people don't acknowledge it.
Yes, I hate him.
Yeah.
I hate all writers. And especially travel guide riders.
So, Penny, you got to get out and start having
get life. Out.
And,
yeah, just get out. You have a life.
You may be better able to establish relationships then.
Yeah. And look, listen, everybody, please, get a friend, get a roommate, get a one-bedroom apartment, and move out.
But one of the things we don't talk a lot about in our society, not to judge.
Don't judge.
But is optimal distance in a relationship. People somehow think that if somebody's altruistic and meaning to help, that if they completely, you know, sort of take over in a relationship, well, that must be good.
Right.
But it can be very destructive. You need to have a distance with it. Like, always got to be boundaries in a relationship.
Yeah. You got to get out.
And reciprocity.
I don't know. I don't know why there's something worse about living in a condo with your parents than living in an apartment with your parents. I don't know why that is. It feels like they have enough money to buy a house. You know, when I hear we're living in an apartment with my parents, I think good times. It's just, hey, what are you going to do? The man's keeping you down. But when I hear condo, it's like, hey, for another $8,000, you guys could be in a house and you could be sleeping in a converted garage. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You'd be out. Being a little guest cottage or something. Somehow condo, it's like that's where old couples go to retire. You shouldn't be living a condo with your parents. Mm. Get the hell out of there. Yeah. Oh, you know, I never really thought about it, but 3/4 of the kids I grew up with lived in apartments with their parents.
Wow.
It's horrible.
Oof.
Ugh. At one time or another. What it is, they lived in a house for a while, then the parents divorced, one of them moved away. House got sold, moved into the apartment. And these apartments, God, I'm just looking back on them now. They were like, everyone there was in the same shape.
Yeah.
Everybody had sort of a broken family. It was never a couple living there. Right. It was the mom and the two kids living there. Almost exclusively. The dad either moved away or kept the thing
around. In Southern California, it's metal windows. The hallways out of doors. Multi-level. Pool in the middle that no one ever used.
Right? Yeah, or the back that no one ever used.
Right, with cement all the way around it. Just a cement slab.
Ugh.
Yeah.
Right off the freeway. It was always right off the freeway, too.
Yeah.
And, yeah, just bad.
And with the address written in cursive.
Yes.
Yes. In a horizontal.
Sometimes, it would always, they would christen it, you know? Yeah. Like once, it was always, sometimes it was the estate of the street it was on.
Yeah.
The Clump Estates or something, you know? The Whitsitt Estates or Manor.
Man.
And then once in a while they christen it like a tuna boat. Just be the Ginny Lynn. You know, the guy was banging some real, the guy owned the thing was banging some chick named Ginny Lynn or something. A little sparkly in the stucco out front.
Oh, yeah.
Bad Tahiti theme.
That's cottage cheese. Yeah.
Smelled like the last guy who lived there. And anyway, here's what it was. All the kids were between the age of like 12 and 17.
Yeah.
No one made it there past 17 because the kids all, they all went run to prison away. Or ran away but or did something like
everyone,
that.
A few families had like 3 to 7-year-olds.
Yeah, there's a couple little twerps running around, but it was always just a bunch of 14 and 15-year-olds and single moms who had to work all day, and the kids would come home from school or cut school, but they'd get home at 3:00. Mom wouldn't get home till 6:30. It'd just be some kind of weird orgy going on over there. Just people smoking weed and banging.
Oh my God.
Just huge.
Bio matter.
It really was. It was like one of those laundry balls of white trash. Just a big mass of people banging, you know, cousins and friends and upstairs and downstairs. And
you know,
who's got some weed?
I don't know if people can appreciate the...
Ugh.
Yeah, that is a Southern California thing you're describing here. That empty, deserted, cultureless...
Right.
White trash.
Nothing.
Yeah.
They're all designed the same way. It had the glass front door that had seen better days, the aluminum glass front door. That went in into a sort of a courtyard. It was two stories, and the units would be on either side of the courtyard. The courtyard had a planter of dead stuff in the middle of it. Be like one rubber tree that survived, but the other stuff would just be dead around it. Sometimes a pool in the parking would be in the back.
Like a motel from what was the movie where the woman got killed in the shower?
Yeah, that was Psycho.
Psycho from Psycho.
And let me tell you what the cherry on top of the white trash sundae was. The sprinkles on top of it was the bad rust-colored carpet, shag remnants, duct tape around the stucco pillar that was in the parking garage because too many people scraped their car on.
Yes.
That was, oh, that is a class move. You see that bad rust-colored shag that's just duct tape around it because old man Winters pulled his Buick into it one too many times. Oh, I should kill myself. That's what I'd like to do, Drew.
Kill yourself?
No. I'd like to build a time machine so I could go back.
And kill yourself.
And kill myself.
Yes, yes. That'd be quite something.
Huh? Mm. Sammy?
Yes.
Yeah, but you'd never know I did that because we wouldn't be having this conversation.
Yes, but somehow the world would be a better place.
Oh, absolutely. Yes, yes. Sammy?
Oh, hey.
Hey, you're 28. What's up?
Okay. I'm in love with my boss.
Uh-oh.
And there's a problem. He's married. He has kids.
Does he know you're in love with him?
You know, see, the thing is I try not to flirt with him, but I can't help it.
Does he respond? Do you have a relationship with him?
Well, no, we don't see each other outside of work. Well, we have a couple times, but those were work-related.
Have you ever had sex with him?
No.
Okay, so you just have a infatuation with him. You have a fantasy. Well,
yeah, but I haven't liked anybody else since I started working with him.
No, but listen, that's, first off, it's totally natural for a younger woman to be attracted to her older boss. I mean, I know.
No.
Lauren and I have that here.
You noticed?
Yeah. Yeah.
She tries to hide it.
She does a fine job of hiding it. God knows she tries, but it still bleeds through.
It's too hard.
Hey, talk to Lauren. Believe me.
What kind of work do you do?
It's pretty much office stuff.
Mm-hmm. And what's so great about this guy? Now, part of the reason, ironically, the ladies love Drew is because they hear what a good family guy he is. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Is that part of it? Does he love his wife? Does he love
really
his kids?
He doesn't talk about his wife or kids that much, no.
Oh.
I think the biggest thing is that he's so smart, and he's so cute, and everybody loves him, and he's so personable, and he's funny, mm-hmm. and he's just so nice.
Yeah, that's what Lauren says when I'm not around. He's so nice.
But it's so hard because I try not to flirt with him, and I like try not to even look at him, but it's so hard.
Right. Is Lauren does that too, but just because she's short. She looks at me in the sternum.
Yeah, I noticed that.
Now, what business are you in, or is he in?
Well, it's a manufacturing company.
True. Let me tell you something about you and whacking the mic.
I don't disappoint.
But let me say this. You are like a great prize fighter who can knock you out with a hook, an uppercut, right to the body. You never know where that punch is coming from.
I prefer to think of myself as an octopus.
You will whack that mic with a coffee mug. I've seen him whack it with his glasses. Mm-hmm. Tonight he whacked it with his headphones. He'll smack it with his chin. And not to mention the elbows, the palms, the wrists, I mean, the fists, shoulders.
Mm-hmm.
I'll tell you, I never met a guy with as much mic whacking range as you have, yeah. Drew. I swear to Christ, you're going to hit it with your liver one of these days.
My tongue is my goal.
All right. Sammy?
Yeah.
You're cute too, right?
Well, yeah.
Here's what I'm hearing. Here's what I'm hearing from Sammy.
Okay.
Sammy is kind of hot.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Well, chicks named Sammy are always a little bit hot.
Cool.
But you're attractive. I mean, guys are into you.
Yeah, I guess.
Are they?
Well, there's some, yeah, but they're totally
you're fat.
Not my type.
Drew, please. What's that?
They're
totally not my type.
Yeah, I know, but what I mean is you're the... See, here's what I'm hearing, and this is an interesting thing, Drew, which is they're girls. All girls have their fantasies about whoever. Well, I'd like this guy, but it's, yeah, might as well set your sights on Brad Pitt. It's not going to happen.
Right.
But cute girls are actually sort of frustrated
right.
when a guy they're
right.
into, especially a guy they see on a daily basis, is not trying to put their tongue in their mouth.
It's not even frustrated. They're confused.
Yeah, it's kind of like, and there's always a sort of feeling like if I ever did want to squeeze a trigger, I would.
Yeah.
I mean, if I had just two wine coolers, I'd do it.
Mm.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Right.
Well, the point is you need to go have a real relationship. You need to
right.
you need to just work on that.
Yeah, but that's the thing is I don't like anybody else because I
yeah,
like
well,
you only like this guy because he's a fantasy. But believe me, if you hung out with this guy for 6 months, he wouldn't be as funny and he wouldn't be as nice.
Yes, he would.
Yeah.
Well, find somebody. There's not just one of these guys.
Do you think he has any interest in you?
I don't know.
But here's
was he ever, like, I'll tell you, does he ever say, like, hey, I had a dream about you the other night?
No.
Or any of that's, no. All right, he ain't interested.
But he winked at me once.
Does he know who you are?
Yes. But, we were in a meeting together, and he cracked a joke about my job, and he winked at me, so. Little
oh,
of me, I took
oh, baby.
Oh, my God, he wants me.
yeah, listen, you're building a dream on.
I know. He's so
swamp.
Hot.
Yeah. You got nothing here, baby. Just go get some normal guy out there, would you?
Oh.
Here's the thing. Here's what I'm reading. Is it this kind of guy in her peer age isn't interested in Sammy? But here's one that has to be in proximity all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Also, she can't have, but has to be around her at least.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the one I'm going to focus on.
It's amazing, too. You know, the guy probably manufactures curtain rods or something, or shower curtain rods or something like that, the telescoping ones that they twist into place with a little rubber boot on the end of it.
I'm just thinking about Schmidt.
Because he's up two notches above her, and he's got a little juice, and he makes 59, and that's before bonuses. He can go as high as mid-60s on the salary. It's like he's God. He is her God. He's it. Oh, man. Yeah. I feel bad for Lauren now. No, must know how she feels. Huh?
Shh. She's listening.
And it's got to be tough, too, because I'm the real deal. You know what I mean?
Oh, there's no finding another Adam Carolla.
Oh, no.
You know, this is it.
Poor Lauren. I got to say, on her behalf, to stop, please, for her, because she can't get on the mic and talk and defend herself. The poor girl.
She's fanning herself. She's swooning.
No, she's over there making faces. She's
swooning.
Yeah.
Yep.
She might love you because you actually talked to Tori Amos last night. That's the only reason why she would love you right now. Not a wear off.
Yeah. Yeah, but that won't wear off for many years. And then Tori will come back and I'll get a booster shot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Let's take a break. These are those gold dust moments.
We had some gold dust moments with Tori last night.
I felt like there was a whole different Tori last night.
You did?
It was just a different kind of series of conversations that we normally have with her.
Why? What was different?
Not that she was different. We just got into different stuff with her. Mm. Usually she has a little bit of politicizing and grandstanding. And this was more about people and her feelings and things. And this was interesting.
Mm, well, maybe,
it was good. I thought it was good.
Maybe motherhood has mellowed her just
a
little bit.
No, if you remember last time, she was like on the attack. Like,
oh, yeah, but she just bat out the kid,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
You weren't here last time.
No, I just remember thinking, wow, a new Tory. You know, she's no longer interested in world peace. She's worrying, thinking about kicking a little ass, make sure her kid's protected.
I like that.
Yeah, it was good.
All right. We'll take a... that kid's got it bad for me, too.
The three-year-old?
Tori.
Oh, Tori, I see.
Lauren and Tori's kid. What's her name? Yeah. All right, we'll take a quick break. We'll be right back. Hey, LoveLine. Yeah. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Dickie Barrett from the Mighty Mighty Bosstones. Dear, 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 dear.
Wah!
Friend, Dickie Barrett is going to be in here. Yeah. Get to see Dickie every day now. He's over at Jimmy's show doing the announcing.
Wah! Nice.
What a guy. Good people. Yeah?
Yeah.
Jeff?
Yeah.
You're 26?
Yeah.
What's up?
Dr. Drew, I heard this report I think it was the BBC or something like that, about how they're putting ecstasy through trials here in the States to deal with people with PTSD.
They've talked about that for a long time. I don't think that that has actually been initiated because of the potential risks.
Well, apparently it is.
I don't think so. I really don't think so.
It's interesting because I just did a quick search on the internet for it.
Yeah.
And I only found it reported in England and Australia.
Where they're doing the studies.
No, actually, they said it's American studies being done in Florida.
Germany.
No, they have done them in the past. They were abject failures. There's talk about doing more studies.
What's the plan? Because you have post-traumatic stress disorder. Yeah,
which is a devastating...
You go into a depression.
Yeah, you got to understand that... Well, no, post-traumatic stress disorder can be absolutely devastating. Yeah, you can have no life, can't be able to get out of bed, you can't work. And so using a dangerous medication to try to improve those symptoms, people are arguing that, well, it might be worth it if it has some effect on somebody
Would you have to use it daily? Small doses?
I don't know what they're talking about.
Well, what would it do if you just took a little bit of X,
Well, listen, one of the goals may be to try to destroy some brain tissue that might be overactive or something. You know, that might be one of the beneficial effects.
Just use a snow shovel.
Right. Well, they used to have lobotomies. They used to put picks up there and do lobotomies. But, again, most of the stuff I've read suggests they're not going to go ahead with it because the risks are too great. Can't control it.
Mm-hmm.
Not in this country, anyway.
Nah. Stephanie?
Yeah.
You're 21?
Yep.
What's up?
Just 1 second, Stephanie. One quick. Okay. I just got to finish this thought. People have great misconceptions about using medication that are potentially dangerous to try to improve devastating illnesses as opposed to healthy people using medication that can't do anything to improve their health but can only hurt them. See what I'm saying?
Right. You're saying
that you wouldn't take a chemotherapeutic agent. A healthy person would want to take that, but somebody with a bad disease, it might have a better outcome for them.
Right.
And the same is true of things like this. There are mental health conditions that are just devastation.
Yeah.
And you might use very dangerous medications in that situation to try to make things better.
Yeah. You wouldn't take those kinds of risks otherwise.
You wouldn't. A normal person wouldn't subject their brain to that.
Right. What's chemo mean? Does it mean something?
Just chemotherapy, chemical therapy, basically.
Oh, chemo is chemical?
Yeah.
No.
I don't know where that came. I don't know what the history of that is.
All right. Chemo doesn't sound like chemical. It sort of does.
Yeah.
But not quite. You know my children's book.
Yeah.
Chemo Skinny Calves.
No. Oh, is he going to be a Samoan guy?
Yeah, Samoan guy.
Nice.
He's got super skinny calves.
And all the other reindeer wouldn't let him play?
All the Samoan guys make fun of him because they have those huge calves.
And then one rainy day?
Well...
Yeah.
Got elements of that in it.
Somebody fell down a well or something?
The keys to the city fell down a sewer grate, and nobody could reach them.
Except chemo skinny caps.
Well, because his leg was so skinny.
Of course, he could fit through the grate.
He could fit through the grate and grab the keys to the city. And then of course, they rejoiced. But, you know, it's like the idea is all those, you know, it's great. It's because all them Samoans, they wear those... Samoans wear like Hawaiian shirts around their waist, like as under, you know, as pants. You know, they wear like those skirts. You
it's
know,
like
they
a
wear
big flowered
skirts. Yeah. Wear like a diaper, and they got those huge calves.
Yeah.
Right, and they're super stupid, dumb as rocks. A Samoan, Stephanie.
Yeah, I'm here.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. So okay. 21.
Yeah. Well, I was just wondering if it's like any possible way a guy can orgasm without coming at all.
Yeah, two ways. One is, three ways, really. A, he can fake.
Well, that's not orgasm.
B, he can have a retrograde retrograde ejaculation where the semen goes up into the bladder.
Mm-hmm.
And thirdly, he can be sort of empty and not really have much come out, like a few drops kind of eventually make their way forward.
Yeah, why? Something happened? Well,
yeah, that actually happened. And he's, you know, he like made all the moans and groans and... nothing came out. And
well, how do you know nothing came out? Where were you?
Well,
where was his penis?
That's a better question, yeah.
He pulled out, and he was going to come on me, and nothing came out at all.
It's embarrassing. So, it's like, baby, you ready, man? You ready? You can't get a tidal wave of love now, man.
Okay.
Oh, baby, hang on, because I'm going to hit you like a pressure washer. Ah, oh, yeah. Nothing comes out. A little spittle comes out. Doesn't make it enough to drop off the end of his dork. It just hugs down the contours, goes off his balls, and starts dripping down the side of his leg. Yeah, baby.
Is that like a spittle root back in?
Starts to come out, yeah. Sucks back like in. He hiccups and it sucks back like into his sack.
He's threatening to spit in your little brother. Stephanie, I have a question for Stephanie. And this is a embarrassing. I'm sort of ashamed to ask this question, but I'm so curious.
Go ahead.
What do you get out of that as a woman?
Out of what?
Him doing that to you.
Doggy style?
No, I didn't. You didn't specify that. It's the pull out and ejaculate on you. What does that do for
you? And by the way, one of the cornerstones of stupidity is thinking people know stuff that you don't say.
Right, about you. Yeah.
Yes, doggy style. You didn't say doggy style.
Oh. Okay.
All right, baby doll. So, yeah. Do you like it? Do you miss it?
I don't know. I don't really care. I just want to know if, like, he was satisfied with it, but obviously...
Yes, he's fine. He's fine. He's fine. He's fine. He's fine. It has nothing to do with you. He's not attracted to you. He's fine.
This is why, by the way, Drew.
Yes.
If I'm feeling like I'm not going to produce an impressive amount,
yeah,
and I'm doing doggy,
yeah,
I'll shoot a snot rocket onto the back.
Nice. That is all class.
Just like an NBA player
but
running
Stephanie,
down the court.
Let's say he right was able to produce something.
Yeah.
What does that do for you? I'm curious.
It doesn't really do anything for me. I really don't care, but I just wanted to know. I didn't know if...
How come it isn't a negative for women? How come they don't go, that is disgusting. Will you cut that crap out?
No, listen, you hear she really doesn't care. And what is this... this newer trend in society where people do, like, they want to know stuff, they're indignant about stuff, they're angry about stuff, they have questions about stuff, and then when you start pressing them a little, you go, like, what does it do for you? Well, I don't know. I don't care. I really could care less.
Yeah.
I was like, well, why are you asking?
Right.
Okay.
Do you know what I'm asking?
You want to know, look, yes.
I've never asked that question before.
Look, here's the problem. You're saying, who on earth would want to get hit
with the snot rocket?
Well, no, I mean, I actually give him a snot.
But either, what difference does it make?
Who'd want to, right. I'd rather have a guy just hawk a loogie in my mouth than drop a load on me. Okay, fine. Now, you're saying, what's it? Why do you like it? And she's saying, I don't like it. I just feel like he wasn't satisfied. That's what I don't like.
Right, but I don't, that's not quite an acceptable answer to me.
Why? She feels like her partner may have not been satisfied.
Yeah, because
with her.
Because how could you
lady.
Have how could you have a neutral reaction to this disgusting action? You know what I mean,
Stephanie?
Yeah.
Is it your boyfriend?
Yeah.
And he's in love with you?
Yeah.
All right, that's enough.
Shouldn't it be? That is disgusting. Cut that out. Once you get past the yummy phase of the relationship, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, you mean the doggy stuff?
No, not the doggy stuff. The mess.
No, I know, but that's the problem with doggy style.
You can keep your penis in the vagina.
Oh.
It's a novel idea, I know.
Hmm. How do you know you came then? Did you got to see something come out?
Oh, my God.
Huh? No? If a,
so you've actually watched so many pornos now that you...
If a joint jizzes in the woods.
Oh, my God.
And no one is there to see it. I don't know, Drew. All I know is all you people disgust me.
Yeah.
All right, where are we going here, Drew?
Let's go to this one here, too.
Someone wants to sing the Germany or Florida theme.
I'm not interested.
Two? All right. Germany? Jeremy?
Yeah.
You're 24?
Yes.
What's up?
Well, I've been going to the gym a lot recently, and I was wondering if, like, doing a lot of heavy weightlifting can lower your testosterone or sex drive?
No, quite the opposite.
Yeah, it usually raises it.
Really?
But it'll tire you out. If you exhaust yourself, then it will start to go off the other end.
Because it seems like, you know, for like the past month, my sex drive has dropped a lot, you know.
Are you running a lot, too?
No, just weightlifting.
Heavy weights?
Yes.
Heavy weights usually raises testosterone. So?
More than running.
Running can usually drop it.
Can drop it?
Can. It's different people, obviously, but yeah.
Is it that sort of...
Look at what happens to the bodies, and just think about, does one look like a testosterone effect versus the other?
Yeah, you know listen. Yeah, when you get in a long distance run, you start looking like a chick.
Right.
You just look like a postmenopausal lesbian, you know? You just start looking all spindly and knobby and weird, you know? Mm-hmm. And then when you lift the weights, you look like you got some testosterone flowing.
Mm-hmm.
That's a good point, Drew. What about skipping rope?
In between.
What if you sing when you skip rope like I do? Like we go, not last night, but the night before. 24, robbers came knocking at my door as I went out. And I go, they came in.
You can't actually
do that. I asked them what they wanted, and this is what they said. Spanish dancers do... How's it go?
You can't actually do that with your testes attached. You have to remove them for a little while to do that.
I see.
Yeah.
In double dutch, same?
Yeah.
And let me say this. Childhood song, is this the same for everybody? Or does everyone mix it around? It's always the same cadence, you know?
The cadence is the same.
But I think everyone mixes it up a little bit,
I'm sure.
Regionally.
Yeah, I'm sure there's different cultural renditions. But you can't judge them. They're all good.
You can't
They're all beautiful.
Junior producer Lauren, do you know that? Do you know this one? No? Never heard it?
No. Lauren and Adam sitting in a tree.
No, that's not it.
Same cadence.
Not last night, but the night before. 24 robbers. Come on. It's totally different. Totally different. Chris, you know this one? No. What happened, Drew?
Where'd this show go wrong?
All right.
Just started bad. It's finishing bad.
I don't know. Okay. Doesn't everyone have to know that not last night, but the night before one? No? All right. John?
Yeah.
You know the not last night, but the night before 24 robbers came knocking at my door?
You know what? I'm not familiar with that one. Sorry, Adam.
What's going on with my life? What happened?
Hey, let me turn the night around. Let me help you out here.
All right.
Well, first of all, your guy in there who's doing the phone call screening, obviously he's got no love for you. Called in. Okay, get this.
Phone screener Brian?
I don't know who he is. Little chipper young guy.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways, so I'm sitting here listening to the show. I listen every night you guys are on. And I'm hearing you talk about jury duty. My heart goes out to you, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I say, how can we get him out of it? Well, I just got out of my jury duty. And you don't have to lie like the other chick was telling you to do. You can do it. You can be honest. And you can get out of it fair and square.
How?
How?
Do I have your attention? Okay.
You did until do I have your attention line. But go ahead. Tell me how.
No, it's suspenseful. Anyway, so you go in there, and there's a form that you can fill out.
He doesn't want to go in. But I'll listen to it anyway. Go ahead. Form you fill out.
You'll be out of there in 15 minutes. You're
form
done.
You fill out, and?
Anyways, you tell them that your employer doesn't pay you to go, and that's a financial hardship being a millionaire
and all. Absolutely not, John. They question you. They want to know the hardship. They want to see the evidence.
No, I was there 2 weeks ago.
What city? You have a financial hardship.
I was with people.
I'm literally a millionaire, John. Literally.
I was in the box with people that had severe hardships, was begging the judge to let them out, and they were told to sit down.
And when the minute they see my chauffeur... and my mink muff that I use if it's cold. I'm going in there. I'm wearing a vest with an expensive timepiece hanging from the middle button.
Of course.
They know immediately.
I had a guy who lost his business because of this damn stuff.
Speaking through a megaphone like an old style crooner. Yeah, they know. They know that. I ring a bell. My squire comes running. Come on, Drew.
Okay.
This guy's calling from Encinitas.
What is that?
That's in Mexico, isn't it?
Just
John?
About. Yeah.
Just about. It's
where is that? It's deep close. San Diego?
Yeah, down San Diego.
I thought Encinitas was in... I thought it was between Ensenada and Mexico and Tijuana or something.
I'm about 40 minutes to the border.
40 minutes to the border. All right.
Yeah.
All right. All right. So, financial hardship, no good.
No.
All right. Let's take a little break. And listen. That whole part where I go in, let me explain the problem. Problem is I live in Los Angeles. Downtown Los Angeles is not that close to Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. And you got to be there at 7:45 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
And the traffic in this goddamn city is so hellish that I have to get up at 6:30 and just sit on a pack thing. Mm-hmm. I'm not doing it.
I had a woman that taxes. Could not speak English. Could not. They said, sit down.
So really?
You're in the box. Sit down.
Really?
Yeah. I know French, good English.
Hungarian? What was it?
It was Vietnamese.
Oh, really?
Yeah. No, sit down.
Yeah. Let me just... What percentage of Los Angeles jurors don't have a great grasp of the English language? 80%? It's going to be at least... You're hard-pressed in Los Angeles. I mean, I don't think people know this coming from other towns. If you're driving around Los Angeles, the city of Los Angeles, and you pull over and ask for directions or pull into a gas station and ask somebody, you're going to have a hard time finding somebody who speaks good English.
This was really...
And it could be any language, but you're going to have a hard time finding English.
I'm telling you, it is a horrible experience. The judge treats you...
Screw it. I pay enough in tax.
Magnanimously and sort of with like...
Now, everyone's there is guilty.
His thing is like, we're your buddy. If you have to go to the bathroom, just tell us. But your time, your life, that has been crapped
up. Screw the system.
Sit down.
All right. That's it. I'm paying the fine. We'll be back.
Thank you for calling LoveLine. Your call will be answered in the order it seems interesting.
Call LoveLine. Call LoveLine. 1-800-LOVE-191.
Hey, yo. It's LoveLine. I'm Adam. Let's just get professional jurors. You know, like the NFL.
How about just one of your machines?
Oh, yeah. My machine. My ultimate truth machine.
Yeah.
My ultimate truth lie detector, boy. Put all the attorneys, the judges, the courthouses. We need the courthouses. How much do you think it costs, by the way? What does it cost just to shuffle the prisoner back and forth? You know, van's picking him up, got a bunch of guards around him, you know. He's shuffling in with the leg irons on. He's sitting there. Just look at the courthouse itself, you know what I mean? The square footage, the lighting, the stenographer. Mm. How much money in stenographers do you think we charge? Just some guys getting $60 an hour just sitting there piling away. I mean, just picture a good court. And now take it and turn it into the OJ trial or any of these trials. And millions. You understand, for what we paid for the OJ trial, we could have built a school.
Of course. Okay. And run it for 10 years.
Yes. Really?
Yeah.
This is it? Let's just get my lie detector.
Yep.
Huh?
Yep.
I don't know.
Take a couple calls.
Listen, nothing makes sense. I'm like an alien, Drew.
Yeah,
I'm an atheist alien. I don't understand any of this crap. It's such a great system.
Yeah.
OJ's got a tea time at 7 a.m. tomorrow in Florida. The system. And here's the thing, too. I'm not done with these callers. The thing, too, it's like, well, no one said the system was perfect. Yeah, no ass, Sherlock.
Yeah.
These guys killing people are walking all the time on technicalities. Okay, if no one says the system is perfect, then how about we get to work on the lie detector?
Or how about we work on making it a little better? If not perfect, better.
Well, now, as long as there's a human element, there's always going to be, so it's never going to be. All right, good. Hook them up to the machine. I think we'd all be satisfied with that.
Yep.
5 years, we come out with this thing. All the world scientists go to work on this super lie detector.
Microsoft to work on it. Just get Gates on it.
It's done. It's done. Really, what we know about the human brain and the psyche now and all the different things, and just focus on the pupils dilating.
Maybe we just do a functional MRI. There's probably patterns to lying versus not.
Of course.
Yeah.
Look, a little experimenting on a handful of cadavers, few inmates, a couple of controversial tests, and we're done. And then the machine becomes 99.967 accurate, whereas the jury... Well, here's what you get. You get OJ walking. That's what you get. Okay? Good enough. What? The system's so great now, and anyone who's got a few bucks can just buy their innocence? Oh, that's a great system. Oh, that's great. That's just what the Founding Fathers had in mind. This is good. All right. I'm done. Danielle?
Yes, hi.
You're 18?
Yes, and I apologize. I sound like a man. I have a really bad cold right now.
That's all right. Go ahead.
Anyways, I had a question.
Yes.
Yeah.
I was wondering if there's... I'm on Celexa right now, and I was wondering if there's different antidepressants more than others that can bulk your ability to orgasm, I guess.
You can't orgasm on the Celexa?
I don't know. I'm wondering if that's what it is.
Yes, that is what it is.
Okay, I just want to make sure.
Yes, and there are those that are not so apt to do that. Lexapro, which is a relative of Celexa, is a little less likely to do that. And the ones that tend not to do it are Cerazone, Wellbutrin, and Remeron.
All right. Give them a try, baby doll. Tariba?
Yeah.
You're 18?
Yeah.
You going to sing us a Germany or Florida theme song?
Yeah.
All right. You sound fantastic. You guys ready?
Yeah.
I'm ready.
Okay.
Tape running?
Say it again?
Sure. Go ahead.
Oh, it's running.
Okay. Germany or Florida?
Wow. That was nice. You got to be pissed that you sing twice as good as Pink. She's making all that money, right?
Yeah, you know.
Now you're a professional singer, Tariba?
No, hopes. I have hopes.
What are you doing? What are you doing now?
Oh, I sing. Like sometimes I try out for plays or whatever, but my boyfriend, he raps, and we're building like a studio, or we have other people. We're doing something, a little something, something.
All right, I'm going out on a limb. I'm going to make a guess here. Jewish. You guys are Jewish?
No?
What?
Oh, we're Hebrew.
Hebrew, that's what I thought. You got a Hanukkah coming up.
Israeli, she's Israeli.
We don't celebrate Hanukkah.
Are you Mormon?
Really? Yeah. All right, so now what do you... So, but now here's the thing. It sounds like you got some good pipes, Tariba.
Uh-huh.
You got the look.
I got the look.
You do?
I could do the supermodel thing sometimes, or maybe in the yard. No, but it just depends. I'm versatile.
You're good looking. You got big pipes. You might be able to make a career here. Give me one more Germany or Florida.
Okay. Germany or Florida.
Wow. That's solid. All right, listen here, baby. You a big gal?
Am I big? No. Yeah. I'm 5'6", 165. Mm. It's evenly distributed.
That's right. That's what I like. All right, well, listen, Tariba, thanks. That sounded amazing. We're going to we'll work you into the rotation. We got to run because we're pressed for time. But don't ever lose those dreams, baby doll. And we'll
or
be
you
right.
Lose your mind.
Or you lose your mind. We'll be right back.
Okay, so I know there's nothing wrong with me. So what's up?
So I was like you, and I used to think that these datelines were totally cheesy.
Why can't I meet anybody?
But I tried everything else and thought, what the hell? So I called the dateline and actually met a cool guy.
I called the dateline and I hooked up with some cool people.
Believe it or not, other normal people are out there looking too.
877-889-DATE.
LoveLine. 1-800-LOVE-191. We'll be right back.
Show. I want to thank Junior. I want to marry Tori Amos Junior producer Lauren for doing a great job.
These are those gold dust moments.
Fawning all over Tori Amos. I want to thank I got an eye infection, but it wasn't from semen engineer Chris for coming in here.
It wasn't from chlamydia, to be fair.
Guy's fighting off many, many infections. He came in here anyway. That's a trooper. God bless him. And engineer whoever filled in while he was gone, including Michelle. Engineer Michelle. Phone screener Brian. And senior producer Ann for booking. Great guest. God damn. The last few nights and few weeks. Huge.
Amazing.
Big guest next week, too, as well. And also the Liberace of the potentiometers, Engineer Anderson. So until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
Hey, I got a little question for Dr. Drew.
All right, very good.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for Loveline is Ann Ingold. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.